Welcome to our webinar today, Using AI Tools to Create Primary School Content, Moodle Content. Can you please move on to the next slide? We have to get with us Alexandros Kofteros, primary school teacher and owner of the mathesis.org site. Alexandros, the floor is yours to introduce us to all the exciting things of AI.
All right. First of all, I'd like to thank both Anna and Sarah for this invitation. I'm very glad to be here. I'm a school teacher for the past 25 years. I've been using Moodle for the past 20 years. Actually, in October, it's going to be the 20th anniversary of us using Moodle. And of course, this is the overview of what we're going to see today. I'm going to see a few things about Moodle as a blended learning environment where we use it with primary and secondary school teachers. And this is how we introduced that 20 years ago. And some of the findings, very basic findings from our experience since 2006, where we had the actual pilot from 2004 to 2006, we were testing it. And of course, we're going to emphasize today using generative AI to create content to use in our Moodle courses. And of course, since you're here, I have to assume that we're already capable and knowledgeable of what Moodle is and how to create courses with Moodle. And when used in a blended learning environment, one of the main advantages is that we can very easily put all our content in there in one place so that not only our students have an easier access to them instead of moving to different files, different websites, different links, different evaluations, everything is under one roof, trackable, and with the capability of us giving feedback throughout the day. And of course, these always have multimodal depiction of information, which is very, very relevant, especially to students today. And at the same time, we can use real-time evaluation, even during school day or afterwards. This is an evolution throughout the years of our Moodle website. It started in 2004. Of course, we moved it from a previous site called apoplus.org when we migrated the database to the mathesis.org website. And in 2007 and consequently, we moved to different versions of Moodle. And we're very, very proud of it because in order to use it with primary students, we had to really simplify everything. Today that might look very, very easy to do, but trust me, 20 years ago, you had to really play with the actual code. So what we found is that when we actually introduce one-to-one devices, and that's what we did in 2004 using, of course, open source software and thin clients, but that's another thing. We saw improved student engagement. We saw students collaborating not only within the same classroom, but also with students from other schools. And students were developing soft skills at the same time while learning the curriculum that we're introducing wherever that was possible. Of course, we're not saying that we did that in every single day in every single subject. No, we did that whenever there was a real added value to it. Now, for doing that, especially 20 years ago when YouTube was not what it was today, I'm not quite sure if we had YouTube back in 2004, and we didn't have the prevalence of online digital content, interactive content back then. It took us a lot of time to prepare even a 40 minutes lesson. Even today, to create quality content, it really takes hours of preparation just for 1 hour of teaching. And of course, even though there is a prevalence of available content out there, there are copyright issues. But with AI, what we can do is that we can significantly reduce the preparation time we have today by generating original content that does not have anything to do with copyright. And of course, we can very easily share that, because one of the main problems we had is that even if we created something ourselves and we use some kind of copyrighted material, this is not something that we could share. And of course, this is not advisable to do copyright material without the consent of the original creator. But with AI content, we can do that. We can share content very easily. For this presentation, and of course for my work, I'm using mostly three tools. I'm using Google Gemini, which is quite similar to ChatGPT. It's from Google. It can generate text. I'm using Bing Creator, which is based on DALL-E 3 for image generation. And one of the reasons I'm using this tool is because it offers 15 generations every day, and it supports Greek, because I'm a Greek speaker in school. And I'm also using the Gamma app, which very easily creates presentations. These are three tools you're going to see. Of course, I'm going to do a demonstration. What I'm going to do now is go directly to a Moodle site. Thank you, Anna, for giving this. And we're going to create content for that. It goes without saying, and please consider this a disclaimer. I'm going to speed create the content here. But as you may know, in order to create a course, even a course that's for one period, 1 hour of teaching, it takes very precise organizing and design. We have to have strict and very, very specific learning goals. And though the learning goals are going to dictate the content that we are going to introduce in there. Again, this is a disclaimer. We are going to create some content using AI, but we cannot take the content that's created for granted. We have to check everything ourselves, but it will still save us a lot of time. In order to create a course, regardless of what I'm going to use AI tools for, we still have to sit down and design, create an outline ourselves. Of course, any AI can generate such a list of topics and goals for us, but we are the educators, we know our students, and we are going to set, this is not something the computer or any AI at the current can do. So let's go over this. The general topic. Our subject is going to be important women figures in computer science. Actually, this is something that we've got in sixth grade primary schools in Cyprus and in Greece, in language in one unit. So this is going to what we're going to create a general topic. I'm just going to copy paste what I've already prepared from before. That's it. All right, general topic. Of course, we can have here some kind of description. So we're going through it. That's it. Seems some speed working here. I'm not going to take into consideration fixing idents and bold and whatever. So right now we've got this course here. Now, again, a disclaimer. In order to create this thing here, we must have very, very clear understanding of the content. And as a co-founder of the Cyprus Computer Museum, we've got the content from the museum. So this is something that we already created content, not from AI, but ourselves. And this is a product of painstaking research. So the reason I'm showing this is because I'm not going to take for granted whatever the AI brings, but this is something that I already know and understand the content in order to evaluate whatever AI is going to bring here, that yes, whatever it brings me, it's correct, or no, I cannot accept it. So let's get on to creating content here. First of all, topic one. Topic one is from Hypatia to ENIAC. Now, Hypatia was a mathematician, but here we want Hypatia because the evolution of computers is completely based on the evolution of mathematics as well. So yes, let's have it here. No learning loss, but that's beside the point. And let's go create our first resource. for our first resource, we're going to create a page on Moodle with information on Padia. Apologies for any spelling mistakes. It's just, okay, save and return to course. Now, there is no content here, just, so what I'm going to do, I'm going to Gemini. Gemini is an AI tool, apologies for the Greek, but here is the prompt. You can use your Gmail account if you've got one, or you can use ChatGPT as an alternative. Write me a short essay on Hypatia and her role in the history of mathematics. Also point out why she is so important as a woman figure for primary school level students. Now, the prompt in any AI program is very, very important, because the more precise information we give here, the better the end result is going to be. So let's see what's going to create. What I can say here, okay, give more historical information on Hypatia, including date of birth, significant work and findings. Of course, we can change the prompt and we can enlarge the text, but that's not something we want to do now. We can click here and we can copy and then go back to our Moodle, and we're going to edit the file. What we have is a complete and original page with text on Hypatia. Now, this is something, of course, we could have written ourselves from various sources, or we could copy from Wikipedia, or even just add here a Wikipedia link. The thing is that if I use a Wikipedia link, Wikipedia links, they contain a lot of information. And it's not very easy for students, even for adults, to get the exact information they need. But using Gemini here, or ChatGPT if you prefer, we can customize the amount of text and the result. But again, Gemini might show information that is not, they're not 100% valid. So this is a disclaimer. And again, unless you have a very good understanding of the life of Hypatia or anybody else, this is not something we should take for granted. Although most of the time this is correct, but you have to check it out. So we've got Hypatia here, which is great. Now, I'm not downplaying the importance of adding Wikipedia links or links to any other website. So yes, we can go to again and just add a very nice link. So yeah, it doesn't mean that we cannot have why is she important? Because she was one of the leading people who calculated the return of Halley's Comet. All right, okay. No, we don't want to pick. So what we have here is an original text and, of course, a link to Wikipedia. Now, we're going to use another tool, which is very important. Now, Bitnose is not one of the tools that I mentioned before, but this is something nice if we want to have some kind of introduction. Now, to do that, I'm going to search, of course, for Ada Lovelace on the internet, which is one of the earlier mathematicians And she's considered the first computer programmer on the world. Now, this is Ada Lovelace. So I can either use her portrait, or I can go to one of the image creators like Bing.com, which is based on DALL-E, or on Stable Diffusion Web. Now, Stable Diffusion Web is very, very capable of creating complex images, and it can even generate images based on real people. For example, the Pope sitting on his throne. Whereas Bing Create, it has more, let's say, protection from unauthorized use, so it will not generate images of real people. Having said that, we have only 10 credits every day. That means 10 images every day, whereas Bing, we have 15 generations every day. But with every generation of images, Bing usually creates a set of four, sometimes three images. But for this one, let's try to do Ada Lovelace sitting on a chair. Now, Ada Lovelace is considered the first computer programmer. She published an article on how to calculate Bernoulli numbers on the analytical engine designed by Charles Babbage in England. Now, generate. I can choose a style here, and problem with these pop-ups is that they get in the way. So we can either use a portrait found on the internet, or we can generate an image. Okay, not bad. I mean, if we go to Ada Lovelace here, here, it's quite good. So we can either use a generated image, an image we generated, or we can use a real image. Let's see where, that's it, it's images. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to upload the image we created on this here. All right. We can even create a background, remove the background. We will not do that. We can choose, a voice, English Cora. There are many voices here, and we can ask Lady Lovelace to talk about herself. Now again, we can go to Gemini, generate a short dialogue of Ada Lovelace introducing herself. Okay, so this is an introduction between Ada Lovelace and Charles Babbage. So this is something that might come up. Again, I'm not going to spend more time on that. All right, and we generate it. Now this is the free version of the program. We can have up to 3 minutes every month of creation, which might be enough for simple videos. And it allows us to download any video we generate and then upload it as a...
Hello, I am Ada Lovelace. I am considered to be the first programmer in the world.
Okay. So for some reason, I cannot see...
Hello, I am Ada Lovelace. I am considered to be the first programmer in the world.
For some reason, I cannot see her lips moving. Apologies for that. Because this is what it does. It recognizes the face and it creates the lips moving. But anyway, maybe we come back later to that.
Could be related to the fact that we are sharing screen.
Probably something like that. But this is very important because it recognizes the face and the lips and it creates a real lip sync. So especially when we have younger audiences where we want to captivate their attention, we can do that. We can upload that as a file or on YouTube, and we can include this. Lady Lovelace introduces herself with the actual video here that we can upload. Unfortunately, because this is not, we're not using the commercial version, we cannot embed it. If we embed the video, that means that we can have Lady Lovelace inside. Of course, there is an intermediate way. We can upload it on YouTube and then we can embed the YouTube video here in our page. So that's it.
Hello, I am Ada Lovelace. I am considered to be the first programmer in the world.
All right. So we've got here our course where we have important women figures. So and we even have a video of Lady Lovelace introducing us. And of course, we can have more information. What we have here is a document with text, a link to website, and an actual video where a historical figure is talking about herself and is introducing herself. So let's go to another thing. The first digital computer is considered to be ENIAC, the electronic numerical integrated analytical computer. And the first real programmers of ENIAC were women. These amazing pioneer computers, we don't know many things about them. So how about we create a presentation about this? So now we're going to use a tool called Gamma App. And Gamma App, again, it gives us 500 credits whenever we create and we log in with our Gmail account. And we can create a PowerPoint presentation or a PDF file. We can import a file, actually, so it creates a presentation. But right now, we're going to generate a presentation. Now, we can generate presentation or website or the document. We can select the number of slides for the presentation, the language, and of course, we can have here the description. Original ENIAC women programmers. Again, here is the prompt, quite similar to what we have in Gemini, and we can generate the outline. So this is an outline for a presentation file, and it was created in fractions of in mere seconds. Of course, if we don't like some of this, we can rearrange it. We can delete some of this, and we can even select the amount of text on every slide and whether the images that are going to be used are going to be created, be selected from the internet with specific image licenses, or we're going to create them using AI. For the time being, let's leave it as it is. And we can generate this. All right. That's it. Generate. Okay. No, we don't have. Can regenerate this. That's it. And wow, for some reason I cannot see the generate button. Continue. Sorry, it was hidden. Sorry. Now it shows me here some styles. Of course, I can either use the predefined or I can change style, and I can go to generate. So what's doing now, it's creating a PowerPoint presentation based on the specific outline, and it's even adding the text for every slide. And of course, it's even finding images from the web that go with this. Keep in mind that, again, we need to scrutinize. Something that is not valid. We need to scrutinize both the information that's shown here and the images as well. Now, Gamma is a very capable tool. And if we like to add some more slides, of course, we can. We got all the tools that we can use. And of course, we can add more slides, we can add more images, but these are actual pictures. And well, from what I can understand, this is quite good, actually. It's quite good. So we can either create more slides or present them online, or we can go to share. By sharing, now we can either embed this presentation within our Moodle site, so it's going to be embedded, that's up to you, or we can go to the export and export this presentation as a PDF file or as a PowerPoint file. For our example, I just exported it as a PowerPoint file. So it's going to export it, it's going to download it. So I'm going to end up with an exported PowerPoint file that, of course, I can edit. I can further edit on PowerPoint or any other compatible application. Now, whether you embed, you use it as a PDF or as a PowerPoint, that's completely up to you. And it's really more dependent on how you want to work with your students. For example, if you're using entirely tablets, I will suggest that a PDF file or an embedded version is even better. But for the time being, let's go here. I'm going to upload that. I'm going to use a file. The ENIAC programmers description is necessary, but I'll just put it here. And this is my PowerPoint file that I'm going to, and of course it's created Commons, upload this file. That's it. Save and return to course. So within less than 10 minutes, we have created original content. Now we can share this endlessly without worrying about any, absolutely no copyright issues. And I think that's one of the main benefits of using these tools. Mind you, we have used here the image of Lady Lovelace, which is long dead, of course. That doesn't mean that if I use, let's say, Elon Musk or somebody who's alive, I can't really do that. That might be an issue, but let's not go there for the time being. Okay. Similarly, I could create more information on other person as well. But of course, let's add another topic here. Digital era. And let's go here, where we can have a small assignment for our students. Okay, assignment. Hedy Lamarr. Now, for Hedy Lamarr, Hedy Lamarr is a well-known Hollywood actress, but she's credited also for the core invention of the core technologies behind wireless communication of it. Now, create an assignment for students on the technology work of Hedy Lamarr. Now, these are the learning of, I mean, this is a lesson plan, right? The assignment. Hedy Lamarr, the glamorous, had a secret life. Now, we can use part of this as an assignment for our students. All right. Any of this can be created and, of course, can be used here with an assignment. So as students, we have to do some research on the internet or on information that we give them. Maybe we also add a presentation or a PDF file that we created and save and return to course. So we create an assignment here about Hedy Lamarr within seconds. Similarly, we could also create a forum with information on the form, and we ask them to discuss that. So whatever we decide to create here is based on tools that we have used to generate within mere seconds the content we want. Again, we need to have a very clear goals that we set before we even launch the computer. That's what I do. At least I go on paper and I create this outline myself. We have a clear structure of what we want to do. We have a clear understanding of who our students going to, our audience going to be, what's the duration is going to be. And then we go to the computer. And of course, let's go to evaluation. I'm skipping some steps here. On evaluation, of course, we can have activities such as these, or we can use the incredible tools that are already available on Moodle. But let's go to something that can be used in the classroom and it's a bit more interesting for students. We can go to quizzes. Quizzes is an online tool that allows us to use AI to create interactive quizzes. So quizzes.com, quiz here, create from, generate from text. Okay. What we can do here is that we can copy paste a piece of text that was created from an AI, or we can use an existing document or add a link from the web, or we can just give a prompt, a quiz on important women figures in computer science. This is very, very generic, and I do not advise that. I mean, if we're creating a quiz, it should definitely be focused on what we taught our students or what the syllabus is. But this is very general. Grade three, whatever grade we have, what's the subject? History, no, it's science, computer science. Number of questions, again, can be five. So let's generate the questions. So it's going to generate the questions here. Now, before it goes there, we can choose some of the names. Ada Lovelace, Grace Hopper, Margaret Hamilton. That's great. We can even Catherine Johnson, to name a few. So let's generate the questions. And Quizzes has just created some of the questions showing us the correct answer. Who is known as the first computer programmer, it's Ada Lovelace. And again, we can change this. Let's say I don't like this question. I can go here, AI, replace with a similar question, or I can just click it. I can even import from Google Forms or from spreadsheet. And this is something, okay, let's see. I don't want to add any more questions. I'm quite happy with that. I can bring more information here. Let's say have cover image. We're going to publish it. Okay. Now we can embed this, embed on the web. Okay. We can either use the embedded link or we can just copy the code and go here. If we're going to add a topic, this topic is going to be evaluation. And again, I'm not suggesting that you use quizzes for evaluation, but this is a very nice playable, especially if you have younger students. So we can have either a page or embed it directly in the text description of the topic. I mean, again, this is completely up to you how you decide to have it. Description, content, we're going to embed the code here. I'd like to apologize if I move too fast with this. I'm just considering that you already familiar with Moodle and how to create content. That's why I'm running with the tools. So let's say save and return to course. All right, we got the evaluation. As I said earlier, we can also embed it here. Personally, I like to have things very tidy, so I don't like to have inline a lot of animations and videos and everything. So we click on evaluation here. That's the quizzes. And I can go there and play now. And we can also play this as well. But that's not the point of what we want to do here. Who is known as the first? Ada Lovelace. Woo!
So this is funny. Anyway, all right. So let's go back to the initial page. Now, in less than 20, 25 minutes, we have created some original content, including a very nice, very playful evaluation that our students are going to like. But again, I like to stress this as many times as possible. This is not something we have to take for granted, or whatever AI creates, as far as text is concerned, we need to scrutinize information. And again, before we create this course, even though it has been created in mere seconds, if I really wanted to create this course to go and teach it to my students tomorrow, this is something that it would have taken me at least an hour, a complete hour to create this. But this is, again, much, much better than the 3+ hours it would have taken me a couple of years ago. So, and the better AI becomes, the less time you're going to spend checking out for mistakes and everything. And we got huge, huge opportunities here. But one of the main advantages here is that whatever AI creates, it's completely completely devoid of any copyright issues. Unless, of course, you're going for things that, I mean, you create something for people who are already in life, and that's another case. So I'm going to go back to the presentation, if I may. And if you want some additional reading, I've got the book that I wrote on Introduction to AI Education. It's in English, Greek, Russian, Polish, Spanish. So we can directly send you the link, or it's going to be uploaded later tonight. So tonight you'll be able to access that. We've got examples on ChatGPT, GAMAP, and more. And this Creative Commons, so you can share it. You don't have to register anything, just download it and use it. Now, the conclusions, pros of using AI for Moodle. Of course, we can create original content devoid of any copyright that we can share with everybody without any issues. And of course, it reduces our preparation time. Now, the cons of AI on Moodle is that, the most serious thing is that currently there is no direct integration with Moodle. For example, it cannot track the activity and put that into the grading. We can do it using intermediary systems, but that's not straightforward. On the other hand, that's completely understandable. And of course, content requires editing by the teacher. We have to scrutinize what we have. If we're going to have a couple of paragraphs creating by Gemini or ChatGPT, it might make more sense to write it ourselves than come back to correct a couple of paragraphs. But if we're talking about a one-page or two-page text, that makes a lot of sense because it's going to take a lot less time for us to correct it than create from scratch. I understand that the time we have is very, very strict and limited. That's why I wanted to finish on time for discussion, maybe go back to the tools themselves. So that's, yes. Yeah, that's as far, yeah.
We do have some comments. Basically, yeah. We do have a comment in the chat. While you were generating the content live, Vanessa said that it's very bold that this is going on live because you never know what AI is going to do. And to comment that it seems that we have a very confident presenter, Vanessa, here, no doubt. Yes. And Miguel is asking, are the AI tools presented compatible with other languages, for example, in Spanish, or do they work only using English?
Okay, now this is very, very important. The AI is especially text generating AI like ChatGPT and Gemini. They use massive amounts of data because these are large language models. So the more content we have available on specific languages, then better the training of the AI model is. Now, the most prevalent language on the internet, for example, where most of the data from the AI is corrected, is in English. But imagine that even with the Greek language, which is last report we had was 0.03% compared to the English language, it's still very, very good. So I would imagine that, and we only have 10, 20 million Greek speakers on the planet at best. Now, I would think that Spanish, they are much, much better in Spanish because of how many million people speak Spanish out there. I'm quite satisfied with the level of quality I have in Greek text. So I guess that in Spanish, it should be much, much better, but I suggest that you try it yourself.
Yeah, I would say that the more we use AI in our native languages, the better they get trained. Yeah. So yeah, go for Spanish and any language. Paul is asking, what is the monthly cost of a starter set of AI tools for each Moodle content developer?
Oh, okay. If we go, this is a very good question. Now, regarding Gemini, it doesn't have any cost here. ChatGPT, it has, we're using ChatGPT 3.5, which is free, but all the data it uses, they stop at 2022, which is quite serious. Very functional, quite serious. With ChatGPT, there is a cost around 20 euros every month, but also includes access to creating images. Gemini, for the time being, they have disabled the capability of creating images from the prompt here. So for Gemini, you can use as much text as you want here. Of course, I'm not quite sure if you use tons of pages, how that's going to affect it. At the same time, if you want to generate images, we can use then Bing in Creator. Bing is from Microsoft Bing, and it's based on the DALL-E system. What it does for a personal account, we've got a Hotmail or Outlook account, it allows you 15 generations every day. I've got 46 here because I had a previous account. It's 15 generations every day. What 15 generations mean? Superman and Batman in space. Okay, let's see here. Once I hit create here, it's going to create 3 to 4 images, but it only counts that as one generation. Of course, Bing, it has, and Bing is Greek compatible as well. I guess it's with Spanish, it's much better at handling several languages. So here it only created 2 images, but it usually 3 or 4. Wow, this is Henry Cavill. Wow. If you go and every day it regenerates 15, so on a daily basis. For online use, this is quite good. But if you're a graphic designer and you want to create something for printing with high quality images, this will not do for you because the resolution is fantastic for screen, but not for printing. It's quite low. You can go to Stable Diffusion. Stable Diffusion is much better to develop real life images. It gives you 10 credits every day, regenerates every 24 hours. And we can have different types of styles. Again, the same thing we can do with Gemini. And now here at the lovely sitting on a chair, we can do it pixelated style. I can select the style. So generate. So again, this generates, I mean, for educational use, for us when we are teachers, these are more than enough. And of course, somebody can create multiple Gmail accounts and we've got more than 10, but that's another case. For us teachers, it's quite adequate. Well, this is a pixelated version. The same goes for similar of the other tools. For Gamma Up, it starts with 500 credits and every presentation creates is 40 credits. Every image generation added 10 credits. So you've got a lot there to work with. But most AI generating tools, they have either some kind of subscription or some kind of a credit system that gives you limited availability for free, and then you have to pay for more, which is quite understandable. But otherwise, you can use text-based AI for quite free, at least for the time being, and you can use image generation with some limitations, which is quite adequate for, let's say, normal education use. And of course, what we expect in a few years, we got Sora, which is coming out. Sora, and obviously you're going to have quite similar solutions. What you see here is videos from OpenAI who create ChatGPT. It's a video which was created with this prompt: stylish woman walks down a Tokyo street filled with blah, blah, blah. So this is AI generated, right? The same with this mammoth. Several giant woolly mammoths approach training. I mean, this is something that was created with AI. Of course, Sora is not yet available and Microsoft announced their own product. But imagine the possibilities where in probably in a couple of years time, or in 6 months, I don't know when, we could give a prompt and we're going to have a small video there. I mean, that's fantastic, especially for education. We can have the circulatory system of a human body. We can have the plants coming out from the root. I mean, these are incredible prospects for education. Thank you. And any other questions?
Yes. Miguel is asking, is it possible to create a bank of questions to use them directly in Moodle?
Okay. Now, as you know, Moodle can create a lot of questions on Moodle here. All right. So we can have a bank of questions already on Moodle. So we can use here with our quizzes. And one of the most difficult aspects of creating, for me, questions on Moodle is that I have to actually sit and think the questions and their answers, especially when they're multiple choice. So that's something that takes a lot of time. Because now with AI, what we can do with AI, we can create 20 multiple choice questions on the life and work of Padia right now. Now, as you can see here, yeah.
Meanwhile, Vanessa is commenting on Miguel's question. If you add your own test in the prompt of which you know what the content is correct, your outcome is better. So that's her comment.
Yes. Yes, definitely. Definitely. What we can do here is we can add our own text and we can ask it to create a quiz based on our own text. So it's going to everything that's going to create. Now, see, to create this, it's generating the quiz based on information it knows, but it's quite correct at least from some of the few things that I see here, maybe it's some, but from quick glance here it's quite correct. And the most difficult thing when creating a question banks on Moodle is not actually writing that, it's thinking, okay, what question can I think of now? But if we've got a set of questions there, it's just a matter of retyping or copying, pasting, or importing that.
Justin has shared in the chat a very interesting tool, a plugin, saying there's a simple community plugin that creates questions directly in the question bank from a text prompt. And the tool is called Local AI Questions. This is really interesting. And I have also another comment about the generation of the questions. Moodle can import different types of question files, like in ICANN format or in XML format. ICANN format is actually pretty simple. So one thing I have requested was from ChatGPT specifically to write me some questions, multiple choice questions in ICANN format. So I provided the format, I provided the content, and it generated quite good questions on the format that I want. So it was easy to copy paste it in the text and upload it in bulk. Also, Vanessa says that if you know the code on how Moodle questions are built, also H5P, you can import them, copy, and in no time. Yes, indeed. Yes, Justin is adding that you can also ask ChatGPT to generate questions in GIFT format and then importing them directly into Moodle. I guess we have all tried similar things. Do we have another question? If no, if I can, actually, Alexandros, I would like, there is something that I would like to ask. I know that you have already started trying these tools and using them live in the class. So I think you're doing this from this school year, if I'm not wrong. How are students reacting? How are students perceive that?
Okay, now this is very good. We started from the first day our students came in September 2023. And of course, it took a lot of preparation during summer to prepare for doing that, which actually led me to writing a 200 pages handbook for teachers as well. To quote Arthur C. Clarke, is any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. So it really motivated them to be engaged in the lessons. But again, you as a teacher, we have to be very, very focused on what we want to achieve. For example, I gave my students yesterday some random information, three random fairy tale characters, a random place, an island, mountain, forest, and a random environmental problem, pollution, deforestation. And they had to write on paper a story with those characters in that place, with that problem and a solution. And of course, then they used AI. They fed it the same words and it generated a story and they had to compare the two. So we are using AI in productive ways. And of course, we're also creating images and stuff, but we're using it in productive ways that have a specific meaning in the classroom. Of course, I use AI tools to create content for my presentations in class. And it saves me a lot of time, but also I'm using it with my students, but in very specific ways where it has a meaning for the classroom.
Did you face from, I don't know, the school environments, I mean, other teachers or parents, most importantly, any kind of reactions?
No, they're very supportive. Parents are very supportive and parents are very enthusiastic that their children are working with AI and they're learning about AI as well. Because I think they trust me that I'm not going to abuse the technology and I'm using it wherever we've got some added value there. So we're not using technology for the sake of technology, which is can have devastating results. So the parents, they trust me. My fellow teachers also, they understand that I never use anything that doesn't have any direct educational value. And it even has a ripple effect because we're using these tools along with other tools with other teachers as well.
Great. That's, I think, yeah, trust is a big word that makes the whole difference in whatever we do, especially educators. Well, we are on the hour. I would like to ask if there are any other questions that you would like to ask Alexandros. Otherwise, Alexandros, we can go back for a little bit to the presentation so we can wrap up. I would like to let you know if you have enjoyed this webinar and you would like to get involved, you can definitely help us grow Moodle Academy by contributing to its development. You may suggest topic ideas from the Moodle Academy front page. You can suggest topics that you would like to be covered in future webinars and courses. You can also contribute to webinars and courses. Presented webinars will get a badge from Moodle Academy, and also we are very keen to have you working with us in creating courses. And also, you can also assist by translating Moodle Academy content. You may help us translate our courses, the content of our courses, into your native language and spread the word. That will help us make Moodle Academy more inclusive. Please help us spread the word. Tell your friends and your colleagues about Moodle Academy and a Moodle Educator Certificate. Remember that by taking the Moodle Academy courses, you can earn badges, and you can also tell others and help grow the community. And if you are an educator, experienced educator working with Moodle, you might be interested in Moodle Educator Certification. And you can take a quiz, a pre-check quiz, to see if you are ready for that and get certified by Moodle. Thank you all. Thank you all for being here. Thank you very much, Alexandros, for joining us today to this webinar. The recording will be soon out. So if you want to take another look and revisit our site. Thank you very much.
Thank you for the invitation. Have a good day.